So sorry for the French accent, but I will try to be understood. Okay, so I will talk about the question of space filling design, and with two colleagues of me, with Guillaume Damblin and Mathieu Couplet, we have worked on the subject of optimization of design in order to have some good coverage of an input space. And we also have studied the sub-projection properties of space-filling design. So first, I will start by a motivating example, the question of uncertainty management in simulation of thermal hydraulic accident in a nuclear power plant. So I work in the French company of electricity. And we have to study the question of possible accidental scenario in our nuclear power plant. Okay, so first we have some very big computer codes simulating the phenomena which can occur when we have some accidents. So for example, we study the loss of primary coolant in the circuit of the power plants. So if we have a break on this cold leg, the water drops out and we have a problem with the temperature fuel. So we have to simulate what happens with this temperature. Okay. So for such study, we have to take into account a lot of uncertainties on the input of the computer codes, like the geometry, like the material properties, like the environmental conditions. Okay. So for example, we can deal with 10 to 50 input random variables. Okay, so we simulate some computer some runs on the computer codes and with the standard tool of EDF and CEA, we have some time cost which can be expensive. Okay, so we are often limited to 100 to 500 runs of the computer codes. And what we want to see in the output of these computer codes is some extremal events. So for example, these curves show 100 simulation of the computer codes, so 100 outputs, which are temperature curves, okay, in function of the time. And we are interested by the maximal temperature here. So we are interested by the configuration of the inputs, which lead to the worst case, okay, and after we can compare it with a safety criterion, etc. So for this kind of computer codes, in a first study, we are interested by a numerical model exploration, okay. We want to test all the possible configurations. Of course, we cannot test all the configurations, but we hope we want to be sure that we haven't forgotten something when we simulate the computer codes. So this is my first motivation, is that I want to test what happens inside these computer codes. So I want to put some points, in fact, in the world space of the inputs. Okay, so just after. So this was just a motivating example on a nuclear accident, but we have a lot of other applications. So to resume this motivation, we want to explore as best as possible the behavior of the code with a limited number of points. Okay, so I have said that I have, for example, 100 of points, and I can deal with an input space of 50 dimensions. So it's a very big dimensions, of course, but we have to do something. So the goal is to put some points in the whole input space in order to maximize the amount of information on the model output. And of course, this goal strongly depends on the dimension of the input space on P. Okay, this is an exploration goal. Okay, so just we can think to be a very simple thing like a regular mesh, okay, of the input space, But of course, when the dimension is high, if we make some regular mesh, the number of points that we have to put in the space is, of course, too large. Okay. So it's not possible to think about regular mesh for this kind of problem. We can also think to make some simple things like a Monte Carlo sample. Okay, so it's a good method when we deal with the uncertainty propagation problem, but when the subject is to put some points everywhere in the domain, we can see rapidly that Monte Carlo is not a good idea because we can lack. For this small example in two dimensions, we have some big zone without any points, and we have some zone with points which are very close to each other. So it's not interesting for the purpose of good explorations. We prefer to be in this situation, okay, when we have small hole in the space and when we don't have any close points, okay? So this is the motivation. We want to discover what happens inside a numerical model. Okay, so mathematically, the problem is to build the design, okay, of n point in dimension P with two constraints. First, we want to regularly spread the endpoints on the p-dimensional input space. And second, another important goal is to ensure that this input space coverage is robust with respect to the dimension reductions. This is important because most of the times we see that only a small inputs are active inside the numerical code. And we don't know a priori these inputs. So we have to discover which are the influent inputs, okay? So we want to ensure that on the Lau dimensional sub-projection, the coverage of the points are also good, okay? This is the question of the effective dimensions. We know that most of the times, in fact, the function, the computer code, the function that we study, has very low effective dimensions. For example, we have 50 inputs, but only 5 are active. So on the projection of the design on the subspace of 5 inputs, we want also to have a good coverage. This talk will be about some space filling design, some particular space filling design. Space filling design is a very broad topic, but we have studied two kind of space filling design. The first based on interpoint distance criterion, so some measure of the distance between the points, and the second based on a criterion of uniform distributions. And in particular, we have studied the Lau discrepancy design. So just to fix the idea, I recalled the most popular space-filling criterion, okay, based on a distance. So this is called the Mindy's distance. The Mindy's distance of a design is the minimal distance between two points of this design. So when we want to build a design which is good with respect to this criterion, this is called the maximin design. We want to maximize the minimal distance of the two closest points of the design. And of course, this kind of designs put the points on the edge of the space, okay? So this is a very popular design because it's easy to compute. Okay, for example, the minimax design is better, but we don't know how to build some minimax design in a very high dimensional space. Okay, So this is the first tool. And the second tool is based on the measure of discrepancy. So what is the discrepancy? Is a deviation of the sample points distribution from an uniform distribution. So in fact, we take a norm, we compare the empirical, okay, so if we take some subinterval of the domains, we know theoretically, in the case of a uniform distributions, how many points we have to have in this interval, okay? For example, if this interval is of volume 1/2, we want to have one half of the 10 of the n points inside this interval. So we compare the empirical number of points with the volume of the interval, and so when this norm is small, we know that we are close to the uniformity. Okay, this is the L infinity norm. In practice, we don't know how to compute this kind of things, and so we compute the L square norm, and we obtain some analytical formula. So this work, for example, there are a lot of works on this subject, but we can obtain by taking various kind of sub-intervals, we can develop different analytical formula. And we have found that the formula based on modified L-square discrepancy are very interesting, because it answers to our questions of sub-projection. You see that between this formula, here we integrate on the p-dimensional space. And this one, we have something different, is that here we take into account all the sub-projection properties with this sigma on all the subspace. It takes into account all the subspace. Okay? And we have seen in the bibliography that this modified L-square discrepancy leads to two, or perhaps more, but I have seen two kind of discrepancy, the so-called centered L-square discrepancy, which consider intervals with boundary one vertex of the unit cube. Okay, and so we have obtained, Ikernel has obtained an analytical formula, so it's easy to compute this formula. So you have just here the coordinate of the points of the design. Okay, so we have a product on the dimension, and we have here a double sum here on the points. Okay, so it can be expensive to compute this when n is large, but it's a very simple formula, analytical formula. We have also another analytical formula, which is called the wraparound L-square discrepancy, but I will not talk about this discrepancy here. Okay, so I have just talked about the criteria, the mean disc criteria and the discrepancy. So now I have said that I also want to have some good sub-projection properties. So a classical way to be sure of the good coverage on the one-dimensional margin. The one-dimensional margin it means that we want to have a good coverage of each input variable. Okay, so a very classical way is to deal with Latin hypercube sample. Okay, Latin hypercube sample is well known. It has been developed in 1979 by Maike et al. And it's very, very simple. It consists in dividing each one-dimensional margin, okay, in n strata, where n is the number of points that we want to place in the design. And we put only one point in each stratum. Stratum? Stratum. Okay. Okay, only one point. So when you choose these points, okay, so you avoid after to put a point in this stratum and in this stratum. Okay, so you choose the second point. So you delete this stratum and this stratum. You put the third point, and after you have only one case. Because yes, one case. Okay, so it's very elementary, and we are sure that we have good uniformity of the projection of the point. Okay, so now we will consider this class of design. So it can be discussed, but enough. It's very classical in this literature. So the problem is that if we want to choose a good design among all the possible Latin hypercube samples, is that we have this number, okay, of Latin hypercube sample. So if n is equal to 100 and p is equal to 50, I don't know what is the value, but I think it's very, very big. Of course, so we cannot explore by like a bourrin. I don't know how to traduce a bourrin. We cannot explore this space. Okay, so we choose to make some optimization algorithm, and there are also a lot of work on this subject. So the goal of this algorithm is to minimize, for example, to minimize a criterion via, for example, the simulated annealing algorithm. So it consists in initialize a design, okay, and we initialize a temperature, and after we make a decrease of the temperature, and at each step we produce a neighbor of the LHS. So to define what is a neighbor of a LHS is very simple, because you can see that just a perturbation of two coordinates, of one coordinate of two points, define a perturbed LHS. Okay, so it's also an LHS, just this kind of perturbations. Okay, so permutation of two components in a column. So after we replace, we define this probability to replace the design by this new design. Okay, so if the criterion is improved, we keep the design, and if the criterion is not improved, we keep the design with a certain probability. And the goal is to be sure that this probability is high at the beginning of the algorithm, and this probability is small at the end of the algorithm. Okay, and we hope to converge to the optimal solution, but we don't have any convergence proof for this kind of thing. Okay, this is the basic algorithm, and in the literature there are some a lot of improved algorithm. So first, excuse me, I have to say something, is that for example, if we want to maximize the MinDist criterion, it's not a good criterion to be maximized. So we have seen in the literature also that it's better to work with this criterion instead of this one. This is the regularized MinDist criterion. So you see that we don't just take the minimal distance, but we take a norm on the distance. And some authors have proven that when q is large, optimizing the two criteria is equivalent. Okay, and we have seen also on some tests that it's easier to optimize this criterion, we obtain better results than optimizing this one. Okay, so this is an example in 10 dimensions and 100 points. We compare the result in terms of the MinDist value, and we have seen that if we optimize this one instead of this one, the results are much better. Okay, the behavior of the algorithm is better. Okay, so I will not detail all this slide. It's just to say that The problem on the simulated algorithm or other optimization algorithm is the cost of reevaluating each time the criterion. But when we perturb the Latin hypercube sample, we perturb just one coordinate of 2 points. So we don't have to recompute all the terms in the criteria. So for example, for the mean disk criterion, we have all this distance to compute, but when we have just make a perturbations, we have only to recalculate this number of distances. So we save some time in the algorithm, and it's the same thing with the discrepancy criteria. The cost is in p n square, and the cost of reevaluating is just p n. Okay, so we have studied two different optimization algorithms. The first is based on a modified simulated annealing. We can choose some different things for the profile of temperature decrease. So this algorithm is good, but the convergence is slow. Okay. There are another algorithm which is based on genetic algorithm, or a kind of genetic algorithm. And we will see that the behavior of the algorithm will be better than the other one. So just to finish with this part, we have made a lot of tests. Of course, this kind of empirical test is just to understand what happens, but we are not sure. We didn't have any convergence proofs about this algorithm, but we just have to test the things. And what we have observed that is this algorithm, the two algorithms are equivalent. We obtain the same value at the end. Okay, it converges to the same value, but this one is less slow, is faster at the beginning. You see, for example, at the very beginning here, we obtain 0.4, and here we obtain 0.51 at the very beginning. So it's faster at the beginning, but after we obtain the same value at the convergence. So we will take this algorithm in practice. Of course, the problem of this kind of thing is to tune the parameters of the algorithm. Okay, so I have finished with this part, and now I want to explain some tests that we have done on the question of sub-projection. So I have said that it's very important to be sure that the design do not collapse on some points when we project the design on, for example, the one-dimensional margin or the subspace of two dimensions, because we know that we have only a small number of input influence, so we want to have good coverage on the one-dimensional projections. And we know that if we have some interactions between the inputs, the interaction probably is of small degree. It means that if we have some interactions, the most influent interactions are only between two variables, perhaps three variables, but not between all the 50 variables. Okay. This is why we want also to test the two-dimensional subprojections. The one-dimensional subprojection is we know that it will be good because we are in the class of Latin hypercube sample. But for the 2D, we are not sure. So we have made this test in dimension... No, not in dimension. 100 points, okay? And we look at the value of the discrepancy of each design, of each 2D sub-projection of the design. So we start, for example, with a standard LHS in dimension 2, and we look at the value of the discrepancy in dimension 2. So we have put some box plot because we have made 10 replicates for each trial. Okay. So after, we build the LHS in dimension 3, and we look at the discrepancy of all the 2D sub-projections, etc. until dimension 10. So we see that when we consider the standard LHS, the value of the criteria is always the same, okay, because we didn't optimize anything. Okay, the sub-projections of LHS in dimension 10, sub-projection is always again a LHS, a standard LHS. So the criterion is not modified. When we optimized, so now we deal with the optimized LHS in terms of discrepancy here, and here optimized LHS is in terms of mean distance. And so we see that when we increase the dimension of the design, of course, the discrepancy increase. Okay, so at the very beginning, we have built an optimized LHS in dimension 2. Okay, so we have a very small discrepancy because we have minimized the discrepancy in dimension 2. But after, if we build a LHS in dimension 6, so the discrepancy is small in dimension 6. And of course, the discrepancy is larger. The 2D sub-projection discrepancy are larger than the one, the initial in dimension 2. And we see a slow degradation of this criterion until the value of the standard LHS, which is the red line here. Okay, this is the same value here and here. Okay. So up to dimension 50, and at the dimension 50, the discrepancy of the 2D projection, sub-projections converge to the discrepancy of LHS. So in dimension 50, if you want to have good 2D sub-projection discrepancy, it's useless to optimize the LHS. You can keep a standard LHS. It's just an observation. And we see that this degradation is faster with this kind of design based on minimal distance. Okay, so what we want to prove here is that if we deal with sub-projections, it's better to work with Lau L-squared discrepancy, okay, than to work with Maximin LHS. It confirms the relevance of centered discrepancy criterion in terms of sub-projections that we have seen in the definition of the centered discrepancy. But here we have confirmed this fact. It's clear? I'm not sure. Okay. Okay. 10 minutes. Okay. Another things. So here I have just looked at two criteria. For the criterion based on distance between points, the mean dis criterion is very simple. So some people have tried to build other criteria for measuring this question of distance between the points. And this is a funny criterion based on minimal spanning tree. So in fact, when you have a design, you can build a tree, which links all the points of the design. And the goal of minimal spanning tree is to build this tree, which minimized the length of the sum of the branch, to minimize the sum of the branch of the tree, okay? And after, so for example, for a random design, I have this tree. And for a Maximin Latin hypercube sample, I have this tree, okay. The tree is not unique. but we can have several trees with the same minimal distance, with the same distance. Okay. So after, what can we do with this? The people have proposed to look at the mean of the length of the branch and the standard deviation of the length of the branch. And so for each design, we can place the design in these two coordinates. Okay. So the idea is to propose a classification of the design. For example, if we have a design with a strictly regular distributions, so the tree will be built, and we know that all the branch lengths will be equal. Okay, so the standard deviation will be zero. So this kind of design will be placed on this axis. Okay, with a design which presents some cluster distributions, we will have small mean and perhaps small or large standard deviations, but the mean will be small. Okay, and with a design, what we want to find is a design with quasi-regular distributions, so which maximize the mean and minimize the standard deviation. Okay. So for example, we can see in this graph I have put what we can obtain from a random design, a LHS design, a Sobol sequences, and the LHS centered discrepancy optimized LHS, and of course, the maximin LHS will be placed like quasi regular distributions. Okay, so we can think that these are the designs that we look for, but in fact, when we look for such quasi regular design, we will have other problems because there's a very strong regularity can mean some points alignments between the points, so it's another subject. But perhaps we have to make a compromise between these two regular design and this not regular design. Okay. So I have just talked about this to explain that the MinDIS criterion is rather limited, excuse me. And we look at other criteria to measure the distance between the points. And for example, I finish with this is one of my last tests. So for the question of sub-projections, we have used this minimal spanning tree criteria. So this is the mean of the branch, and this is the standard deviation. Okay, the standard deviation. So we see that for the maximin LHS, from dimension 2 to dimension 3, we have a drastic decrease of the mean. So we lose all the structure of the LHS in the subprojection of dimension 2. Okay, and for the standard deviation, it's the same thing. We want to have small standard deviations, so for the design in dimension 2, it's good. And for the design in dimension 3, we lose all these good small standard deviations. For this kind of design, we look that the decrease is regular in terms of mean, and the increase in terms of standard deviation is also regular. So it confirms the relevance of the centered discrepancy LHS instead of the maximin LHS. Okay. So to finish with a last example, I just show some tests of Choupette, Amandine Marel, in 2008, in order to fit a meta-model. Okay. So when we build this kind of exploratory design, we can want to fit an approximation like a metamodel, so like a kriging, like a polynomial chaos, etc. So here it's kriging. This is my test function in dimension 5. And I compare what we call the coefficient of predictivity of the meta model between a meta model fitted on a simple LHS and loud discrepancy LHS. Okay, so I want to have a predictivity coefficient to be large. And here, this is the number of the points. Okay, so we can see that we have better predictivity coefficients with good design than with bad design. Okay, this is just to prove that considering the design can be useful when we build some meta models. Okay, so my conclusions. So I have said that building space filling designs is useful in an initial exploration step when we have a small number of points. If you have 1,000 points, using this optimization algorithm will not be possible. It's too expensive. But with 100 points, it can be useful. And large P means that P larger than 5, for example. We have studied two optimization algorithm of LHS. So we have seen that the genetic algorithm seems preferable. But of course, we have a lot of problems to tune the parameters of the algorithm. And after, we have seen that we have confirmed that the modified L-square discrepancy are interesting in terms of properties in subprojections. So we have just test the two-dimensional subprojections, but we have made other tests on 3D, three-dimensional subprojection, and we observe the same things. Okay. The distance-based design shows stronger space-filling regularity, but not 2D robustness. And finally, what will be interesting is to leave this class of latent hypercube sample because it's rather restrictive, and perhaps to work in a more general class of design to try to make things better. So thank you, Anthony, and thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Are there some questions? Yes.
Thank you. You propose a criterion for to build your points that consists in maximizing the minimal distance. But you can think of other criteria, such as minimizing the radius of the largest ball you can put without intersecting your set of points. Have you tried this kind of criteria? Is it relevant?
Okay, it's a good question, but I haven't tried. Also, there are a lot of choice in terms of this criteria based on distance, but the most used is the maximin. So I didn't try other things, for instance. I don't know, perhaps it will give some same things.
In the method you look at, it seems that the uniform law plays an important role, because in each dimension you try to have this uniform law, one point in each set. So I had a question about that. So how, when you design your input parameters, you design them in such a way that you think that each value has the same probability, basically, that so, because there is a choice here to make. If you change x to x square, for example, on 0, 1, the uniform law will not be preserved. So how do you parameterize originally your problem?
Oh, in fact, the when we make an uncertainty study, we don't have uniform law. Okay, we define some probability distribution on each input. We work with what we call an input variables, okay, this which has a physical sense. We don't, so it, we have no reason to work with the square of this input variable. Okay, this is just the first point. When we make an exploration step, we don't consider some specific probability distributions. We want to put some points everywhere, so this is not the question of probability distributions. So we consider that all we take the uniformity for all the inputs. We think it's better because if we put the normal distributions okay on an input, so we will put more points on the central domain. And for an exploration step, we think that we will forgot some space, some domains. This is not an uncertainty propagation step. This is just an exploration step. So the question of probability distributions, we don't consider this question. Of, I'm not sure that I'm convincing. But
yeah, okay, so the purpose is more an, about optimization, maybe with this this class of techniques. But what is the state of the art for goal-oriented space design? Goal-oriented designs in the sense that you introduce the quantity of interest you are interested in. Mm. And so what is the state of the art about these techniques?
Okay, so these techniques, the goal is not very well defined mathematically with this technique. I say that I want to explore as best as possible all the configurations of the inputs. Okay, so it's rather flu. Okay, but so in an initial step, okay, we make this, and after, if we want to, if we are goal oriented, like we want to optimize, the idea is to fit a meta model and to use this meta model to find a. To find good regions to add the points. Okay, this is the same for optimization, but also for finding very extremal events or other things.
So this kind of design can be used as a initial.
It's an initial,
okay, initial design, and then you use adaptive techniques. Maybe that's it.
Yes.
Okay. After introducing the goal of your computation.
But sometimes we have the question from the engineers ask us to make some runs of the computer codes and to test all the possible, enfin, not to test all the possible configurations, but to be sure that we have a good coverage of the input combinations. This can be a goal by itself. Mm-hmm.
Another question? No? So if not, we thank you again.
Thank you.